下面我们就有请上海开放大学副校长、博士生导师顾晓敏教授主持开幕式，大家欢迎。尊敬的各位领导、各位来宾，女士们、先生们，下午好。首先欢迎大家参加2015全球化时代开放大学能力建设国际会议。 上海开放大学自从1997年成为联合国教科文组织远程与开放学习网络主持单位以来，聚焦国际远程开放教育领域的各类热点议题，开展了多次国际学术会议和系列的国际研修班。今天的国际研修班也是姊妹大学网络主持单位的一个系列学术活动之一。 当前我国开放大学的建设已进入到一个非常关键的时刻，改革转型过程中面临机遇的同时，也存在许多困难和挑战。上海开放大学面临的改革和发展问题，与世界各国开放大学相比，具有共性和联动性，那么容易引起大家的一个国际的共鸣。 通过与国外开放大学思想的交流、经验的分享，一起探讨这些共同关注的议题，推动开放大学的能力建设，也是本次会议的初衷所在。这次会议的召开恰逢非洲远程教育理事会 ACDE 的高层代表团来访，以及11名海外开放大学访问学者来校交流。我们邀请相关的专家学者。 共同研讨开放大学的改革和发展问题。下面，请允许我介绍出席今天开幕式的领导和嘉宾，他们是上海开放大学校长蒋红教授，上海开放大学党委副书记王连华教授，前联合国教科文组织高等级远程教育专家王一斌教授。 苏丹开放大学校长、非洲远程教育理事会副主席菲萨尔布杜拉教授，非洲远程教育理事会执行主任罗迪米欧吉代教授。参加今天会议的还有来我校交流的国际访问学者、上海开放大学分校的领导。 以及上海开放大学各院系和教学管理部门的代表，在这里特别值得一提的是，今天参加研讨会的还有我们的学生代表，他们是开放大学服务的对象，对开放大学碰到的问题是最有发言权的。再次对各位领导、专家学者和会议代表表示最热烈的欢迎。接下来，我们有请。
上海开放大学校长蒋红教授致辞。尊敬的菲萨尔·阿卜杜拉副主席，各位来宾、女士们、先生们，大家好。今天我们同聚一堂，共同探讨全球化时代背景下。 开放大学改革与发展的问题。首先，我谨代表上海开放大学全体师生，向非洲远程教育理事会代表团的成员们和来自11个国家开放大学的学者们表示热烈的欢迎。当今世界，知识经济的发展和科学技术的进步。 日新月异，公民的学习与创新能力日益成为一个国家发展和民族振兴的决定性因素。终身学习日益成为个人全面发展和社会文明进步的趋势。开放大学正以其开放的办学理念、灵活的教学方式和积极的社会贡献。 成为各国教育改革发展的重要生长点。中国政府正在全面推进开放大学建设，把它作为满足人民群众 多样化学习需求，促进教育公平，克服应试教育弊端和落实素质教育的重要途径。作为构建终身教育体系、形成学习型社会的重要支撑，作为教育服务国家发展、提高全民族素质的重要措施。上海，作为中国经济改革发展的前沿城市，正在围绕为了每一位学生的终身发展的核心理念，全面推进实现到2020年率先建成人人皆学、时时能学、处处可学的学习型社会的战略目标。自2006年以来，上海市政府举全市之力来推进开放大学建设，将上海开放大学列为上海城市重点建设的工程之一。根据开放大学肩负的时代使命和改革重任，我们上海开放大学秉持为了一切学习者、一切为了学习者的办学宗旨，贯彻有教无类、乐学致远的校训，推行教育观念、学习对象、培养模式、学习资源、师资队伍和方法手段的全面开放，建成了覆盖全市的开放远程教育办学系统和学习型社会建设服务指导系统，搭建起了基于远程网络的市民终身学习大平台。同时，学校坚持学历与非学历教育并举，努力培养具有自主学习和终身发展能力的、适应社会经济发展需要的应用型专门人才，致力于满足广大学习者多样化的学习需求。目前，学校注册在校生规模8万余人，每年线上线下非学历教育培训约50万人次，学习对象已经覆盖老年人、残疾人、服刑人员等各类人员，特别是受教育的弱势群体。目前，上海开放大学正处于事业发展的关键期，面临重大机遇和挑战，学校也正在加紧编制“十三五”事业发展规划，研究制定新一轮改革发展方案，对未来的改革与建设进行顶层设计和系统设计，以进一步优化体制机制，不断加强内涵建设，持续提升创新能力，包括如何进一步扩大教育供给，适应广大社会成员日益增长的终身学习需求，如何进一步提升专业课程和培训项目的质量，满足不同学习群体日益多样化的学习期望，如何进一步紧跟现代信息技术的发展，改进教学方式和学习支持服务，顺应学习者对个性化学习的苛求，如何进一步健全质量保证体系，提升人才培养质量，如何进一步提升社会服务能力，助力上海学习型城市建设等等。当前，随着全球化进程的加快，各国开放大学面临的改革与发展问题越来越具有共性和关联性，我们需要加强与世界各国开放大学之间的交流，共享经验，共商合作，共谋发展。近年来，上海开放大学积极参加 UNESCO 与教育部联合实施的中非高校20+20合作计划，与非洲远程教育理事会签署并启动了合作协议。学校已经与英国开放大学、荷兰开放大学等签订了战略合作协议，推进课程共享和师资建设。学校还启动了国际师生交流项目，已有22个国家和地区的36名教师来到我们学校短期访学， 以及有来自欧洲、美洲、亚洲和非洲23个国家和地区，将近80位学生参加了国际开放大学学生夏令营活动。今天，我们利用海外访问学者进校交流和非洲远程教育协会来校访问的良好时机，邀请相关专家学者就开放大学的能力建设这一主题畅所欲言，深入探讨。这也是上海开放大学推进 UNESCO 开放远程学习姊妹大学网络计划的一个重要活动。我相信与会代表充分的沟通和坦诚的交流，不仅能进一步推进各国开放大学更深入的思考和实践，还能积累共识，扩大合作，为促进发展中国家开放远程教育的实践发挥更加积极的作用。最后，祝愿2015全球化时代开放大学的能力建设国际研讨会圆满成功，预祝各位来宾在上海期间身体健康，生活愉快，谢谢大家。
下面会议进入主旨演讲阶段，有请苏丹开放大学校长、非洲远程教育理事会副主席 Faisal Abdullah 教授做主旨演讲的主持人，大家欢迎。
Dear President of Shanghai Open Universities, Vice Presidents, and the dear colleagues, we are very happy to be in this morning with the capacity building of the Open University in the globalization era, and because I think University of Shanghai is standing in the future of the higher education. So we want to build the capacity for that. And also I like to thank the other partners of this conference. And in this session, we have about 4 speakers. The first one is Kuo Xiaomin, the Vice President of Open University of Shanghai, and she will present the teaching reform oriented by the student competence. And she is well known in this university and also as a standing committee member for Shanghai People Congress and other activities in Shanghai. She has more than 40 papers. I would like to ask her to give her talk. Kuo Xiaomin.
女士们、先生们，下午好，很高兴作为东道主首先就相关问题进行发言。今天我发言的主题是基于学生综合能力提升的教学改革探索。我想大家都知道，也都看过魔术，有大变活人这样的一个魔术，也许一个绅士走进一扇门，出来的却是一位美丽的女士。那么上海开放大学这扇大门，学生进入以后会得到怎样的改变呢？他的能力有什么样的提升呢？这是我们需要思考的问题。近两年我们关注于学生能力提升，正在积极推进这方面的改革。今天我想就这些初步的探索和在座的各位分享。我发言的有四个方面的题目。第一个，我们首先基于一个新生的调查；第二个是教学改革的探索；第三是毕业生的综合评价；第四，和大家分享我们今后努力的方向。首先我想讲的是我们对新生调查的分析。 上海开放大学的学生，首先我们要看一看他是怎样一个群体呢？下面我将以2013年入学的新生调查为例进行来分析。我们来看，从年龄分析，新生来自全国32个省，年龄从18岁到72岁，啊，这个间距非常的大，分布的跨度啊非常的大。其中18到25岁的学生占比是最高的，47.59%。26到29岁的学生占比是19.69%。30到39岁的学生是占26.33%。可见学生的主要年龄大多数集中在18到30岁之间。从择业状况我们可以来看一下，88.64%的新生是在岗的，其中以工龄小于5年的居多，占到，大家看到这张图上占到53.01%。那么从户籍结构来看，10年前的统计数据表明，上海开放大学的学生是以当地的户籍为主，但是近几年的统计数据大家可以看到，我们非户籍的学生在不断的上升，而且到2014年已经接近49%。总体来看，我们的学生有着年龄较为年轻，工作经验相对单薄，外来人口在不断上升这样的一个特征。那么他们的年龄主要集中在30岁前。根据埃里克森的人生发展8阶段理论，大多处于成年的早期。如果这一阶段的所有的危机得到解决，也就是他碰到的困难都能得到解决，就能形成爱的美德。所以他们也正需要关爱和团队的温暖。由于学生较为年轻，所以工作年限也相对的较短，有半数的学生工作年限在5年以下。根据择业生涯规划相关理论，学生的工作是处于择业塑造期，择业偏好与优势特征逐渐显露。而在户籍的组成上，随着外来人口的增多，对于人文关怀、文化的融入等方面的需求也逐渐的显现。在这一个基本前提下啊，背景下，我们的学生的优势和不足或者说特点有哪些呢？第一，我首先和大家分享一下我们学生的优势和不足。正如各位所知，我们的学生大都是成年学生，他们相对于普通高校的学生而言，社会经验更加丰富，价值观念趋于稳定，学习目标清晰明确，学以致用更加迫切。那么开放大学学生既然已经步入成年，他们随着年龄的增长，心理上已向独立自律的阶段转化，自我概念完成形成，能够对自己的行为负责，基本性格也已经定型，逐步形成了自己独特的个性心理特征。他们有自己的社交圈，有较为丰富的社会经验和社会阅历，同时耳濡目染了诸多的社会现象，他们对社会和人生有自身独特的看法，价值观相对成型。80%以上的开放大学学生，由于已经在工作岗位上，对于自己需要什么、需要哪些方面的学习，都有着较为清晰的目标。他们有着强烈的现实紧迫感，介于改变命运，学习动机比较急迫或者说比较直接，希望通过学习这把金钥匙来成就人生。在学习中，开放大学学生学以致用的意识较为强烈，希望在学习和经历，他的学习经历都能够用于实际提升自己，而且通过专业的学习也能拓展朋友圈。可见我们的学生和普通高校相比，尤其自身的优势，但是也存在着一定的短板，或者说是成人学生的一些特点。由此我们根据这些短板呢，进行教学改革来提升学生的能力。主要的短板我们认为，第一，学习的困难。上海开放大学学生有着强烈的学习愿望，但是却存在着明显的学习困难，主要体现在知识结构比较零散，学习方法比较单一，学习伙伴缺位，以及工学矛盾比较突出。学生由于之前没有经历过系统的专业教育，他们的专业知识主要通过自学以及岗位所获取， 实践性很强，但是理论性和专业性比较缺乏。片段化的知识虽然有利于快速解决某一个问题，但却难以在专业技能上实现可持续的突破。学生习惯于传统的授课方式，更多的依赖老师的辅导。我们的调查发现，28.9%，也就是接近29%的学生希望学习中以教师面授为主，21.5%的学生希望教师辅导和自学兼并。可见学生对于学习计划的制定、学习策略的选择、学习过程的监控以及学习效果的自我评价等方面都需要更多的指导和帮助。学生由于业余时间学习，一般没有固定的学习伙伴，遇到学习的困难或困惑，找不到交流与寻求帮助的一些对象，也缺乏群体间的互相一个帮助，存在学习的孤独感。学生大多身兼工作和家庭的多重角色，有许多已经为人父母，工作、生活与学习之间存在着紧张的关系，工学矛盾、家学矛盾较为显著，不能一心专注于学习。第二方面的一个短板是择业的瓶颈。择业对于上海开放大学学生而言是一个非常重要的主题。上海开放大学学生择业发展主要体现在择业它的择位相对较低、择业竞争力不足、发展前景不明这三个方面。我们的学生虽说绝大部分拥有工作背景，但是往往起点较低，工作环境不佳，技术含量不高，岗位容易被替代。正是因为学生的工作技术含量不高，岗位准入的门槛比较低，进而导致他们择业核心竞争力比较弱。调查也发现，学生普遍认为自己的职场竞争力有所欠缺，欠缺的能力主要是创新能力、组织协调能力和实践操作能力，对于自己的择业竞争力信心不是很足。不少学生对自己的职场发展也处于非常茫然的状态。大部分学生进行过择业生涯的规划，他们常常会问，我想跳槽怎么办？我不会写简历怎么办？我害怕面试怎么办？这些问题往往使我们的学生处于矛盾和焦虑的状态。第三个短板，能力素质的差距。上海开放大学的学生由于大都是有社会经历的人，社会经验相对丰富，但是素质和能力却存在着一定的差距，主要表现在自我认知有些偏差、交往能力不足这两个方面。学生大多在以前的学习过程和生活经历有一些不顺，在不顺以后没有进行及时的调整，形成了习得性的无助，造成自我效能感比较低，自我价值感也比较低，遇事有的时候会胆怯、逃避、退缩，难以正确客观地评价自我，难以悦纳自我。我们的学生虽然是社会人、职场人，但是依然存在着沟通表达方面的缺口。很多学生在学习工作中有许多诸如此类的困惑，论文不知道怎么写，工作总结词不达意，应用文行文觉得不够规范，和同事同学在一起的时候交流上好像有一些困难，无法进行良性互动，不知道如何融入团队等等。不少学生由于欠缺沟通表达能力和技巧，因而在工作和生活中更喜欢单打独斗，错失与他人合作的机会。第二方面的调查，我们是学习目的。从以上学生优势和短板分析可见，上海开放大学学生年龄分布跨度比较大，背景多元，择业各异，但是他们都共同的有一个共同的特点，都拥有着对学习的强烈的诉求。从我们的调查中可以看出，上海开放大学学生的学习动机与获得文凭、交际需要、提升素质和择业发展等现实因素密切相关。26%的学生学习的动机在于获取文凭，24%的学生学习的动机在于认识朋友，20%的学生学习动机在于提高素质。在学习目标统计中，28%的学生希望通过学习能够完善专业知识，27%的学生希望通过学习能够更好地适应社会，23%的学生希望通过学习能够提升择业竞争力。可见学生的学习目标仍然集中在专业知识 职业竞争力以及综合素养方面。更进一步，我们又调查了学生选择开放大学的原因，排在前两位的是质量保障和注册入学。32%的学生认为开放大学学习可以提高学习技能和学习效率，22%的学生认为开放大学优势在于注册入学，20%的学生选择开放大学在于可以克服供学矛盾。基于学生的需求，是我们进行教学改革的起点，也是动力，也是方向和目标。为此，第二个问题，我向大家共同的探讨我们的教学改革探索。面对学生的成长需求，上海开放大学在转型发展中不断寻找人才培养的新路径，尤其是为老培养既有宽泛的基础知识，又具备专业的技能的梯形人才的目标。这个理论，我前几次正好和哈佛大学的一个教授进行过一些研讨。梯形人才目标的培养，目前在哈佛大学等西方国家也是非常热门的一个研究的一个课题。我们对于这样的一个梯形人才的培养，展开了一系列教学改革的探索。我主要从以下两个方面介绍。第一，从城市化培养向个性化学习转变。我们知道，常规的培养模式是学生修读统一的人才培养方案，这和普通高校是一样的。虽然设有选修课，但选修课所占学分比例比较低，学生的自主选择范围比较小，并且课程体系较为固定。在上海开放大学，我们为学生提供更多的选择，让学生可以结合自身情况选择适合自己的学习内容。第一是按照模块化理念设计专业人才培养方案。设计人才培养方案时，我们没有打破传统的课程体系，保留了通识课程模块、学科基础课模块、专业课的模块、拓展课的模块和补修课的模块。但是在此基础上，我们提供了模块化的方向模块化的选择，比如专业模块课程中设置专业方向模块、择业资格证书模块、企业合作课程模块，学生可结合自身需要选择不同的课程模块。例如机械电子工程专业中设置了3个专业方向模块：数控技术模块、测控技术模块、生产过程自动化模块。比如说我们的公共安全、城市公共安全管理专业中，我们也有很多方向模块，比如说食品安全管理方向的模块、消防安全的管理、建筑安全的管理啊，这轨道交通安全的管理等等模块。还根据企业需要量身打造了企业定制课程。模块化的课程体系设计突出了对学生择业能力、岗位技能的培养，通过不同的模块选择实现工作岗位实践和课堂理论教学的相融相长，使不同的学生可以走向不同的择业发展方向。同时择业资格证书课程和企业合作课程的融入，打破封闭的课程体系，突出对学生职业发展能力的培养，学以致用。第二是制定专业规则，指导学生自主选课。上海开放大学部分学生对自身职业发展有着清晰的认识，在学习中更关注对原有知识结构的补充。对这类有着明确学习目的的学生，可通过我们的专业规则，有针对性地完善他们的知识结构，提升岗位技能。同时在行业融合趋势日益明显的背景下，对人才的需要也从单业的学历背景向跨专业、跨学科背景转变。通过专业规则，学生可自行搭配学习内容，文理兼容，使学习跟上行业发展的步伐。上海开放大学的专业规则，我们有两大特点。一是学生完成在总学分60%的核心课程后，剩余学分可以自主选课，包括跨学科、跨专业，包括是人文类的啊，都是可以修读这样的课程。二是学生已有的学习成果和岗位经历等，可以申请学分认定和转换，避免重复学习。第二方面的探讨是关注目标向关注过程转变。与普通高校学生相比，上海开放大学的学生对学以致用的要求更加迫切。为此，我们制定了更为灵活开放的学习管理制度，强调学生在学习过程中的提升和发展。在这方面的做法，我们是第一个是开放的学习制度。上海开放大学注册入学，学生中既有青年，也有中年，还有老年。我们刚才 在调查分析中已经见到看到数字了。学籍八年有效，学生可以在八年内根据自身发展规划合理安排工作和学习，在课堂中和岗位上共同获得知识，提升能力，同时学分互认，学生已有的学习成果和岗位经历可转换为学分，实现教育资源和职场资源的优势互补。在宽松开放的学习制度下，学习不仅仅是获得文凭或者证书的任务，而是一段成长经历，并在过程中不断扩充学习的深度和广度。第二，针对性的择业发展能力培养。学校不仅注重对学生专业知识的教学，同时重视对学生择业发展能力的培养。学校通过开设择业发展课程，尤其是今年开始，我们特别关注学生择业发展能力的提高，搭建求职就业平台，开展择业规划辅导等方式，助力学生择业成长。例如我们聘请择业导师录制择业发展指导课程，并举办专题讲座。我们联合政府企业共同开展就业服务活动，包括职场体验活动、专场招聘会等等，让学生保持与就业市场的密切接触。我们还将择业规划辅导与咨询贯穿于学生成长的全过程。在学生入学时，对其择业背景和发展愿景开展调查，并针对性地提供专业和课程选择建议，帮助学生确立择业目标，选择择业通道，并通过学习实现自己的择业生涯目标。第三方面的探索是多途径的素质教育。我们在学生培养过程中，不仅注重对学生的知识能力的教育，也通过各种形式加强对学生的素质培养。一方面，在人才培养方案的培养目标和培养规则中明确对学生的素质要求；另一方面，为学生搭建沟通交流的平台，引导学生成立各种学生组织。今年我们也是大力地推进了这个工作，包括学习小组、学习型家庭、学生会以及各类学生社团，互帮互助，共同成长。学生在实践中不断提升自己的合作意识、心理素养、规范意识等等，并通过学生间互相的帮助增加亲密关系，促进学生心理和情绪的健康发展。另外，开展丰富多彩的校园活动，包括文艺汇演、美文诵读、羽毛球比赛、乒乓球赛、摄影大赛等活动，陶冶学生的情操，塑造拼搏意识。第三个大题目，我是跟大家汇报一下我们毕业生对我们做的这些初步的探索的综合评价。那么让我们再回归到最开始的问题，通过这样的改革，学生的困惑是否得到初步的解决了呢？学生的能力是否得到提升了呢？我们以上海开放大学松江分校2014年开展的毕业生调查为例，从数据中去发现学生的变化。从毕业生反馈的数据看，学生认为自身能力得到了不同程度的提高，其中排在前三位的是学习能力、思维能力和人际交往能力。第一，能力的增长。在知识方面，在44%的学生认为思考、分析、解决问题能力得到了提高，其次是学到了扎实的基础理论和专业知识。在实践技能培养方面，26.88%的毕业生认为在校期间获得的各项职业技能证书对自己的就业有非常重要的帮助，41.89%的毕业生认为比较重要。总体而言，接近70%的学生对在校期间获得的择业证书采取了肯定的态度。最值得欣喜的是，学生不仅在学历层次和知识水平上得到了提升，更重要的是培养了终身学习的意识。在调查中，学生不再止步于当前的学习，更愿意采用不同形式进行继续深造。39.04%的学生选择技能培训，32%的毕业生选择继续参加学历进修。第二方面，择业的发展，我们对学生也进行了测评。知识和学历的提升有助于 学生择业的发展。22.63%的毕业生认为所学专业对自己的就业非常有帮助。44.27%的毕业生认为比较重要。可见在校期间进行的专业学习，对于学生择业竞争力的提升起到了非常重要的作用。从晋升程度看，学生毕业后择务得到晋升过一次的学员有36%，晋升过两次的学员有3%，说明有接近半数的学生通过学习后实现了实质性的一些成长。从薪酬变化看，58%的学员的薪酬有提升，其中7%的学生薪酬有较大幅度提升。除了薪酬和择位的提升之外， 我们的学生也有通过择业发展指导后自行开展择业发展的沙龙，或者是自行创业的，甚至不乏我们自主创业的一些榜样啊。后面我还会讲到，比如徐汇分校的学生不仅建立了创业联盟社团，还成功指导了同学的自主创业。第三方面，素质的提升。上海开放大学学生不仅是一名优秀的学习者和择业人，更重要的是具有当代素质的合格公民，他们在诚信度、合作能力、社会贡献等方面是有所长进的。通过日常的诚信教育，学生不仅注重在校期间的诚信行为，更加注重自己在社会生活中的诚信指数，能够更加深刻地理解社会主义核心价值观，并以此来规范自我的道德行为。通过丰富的社团活动，学生不仅丰富了业余生活，更锻炼了策划、组织、宣传、沟通、合作等各项能力，变得乐于交往、敢于表达，甚至结识了不少志同道合的好伙伴。更重要的是，学生在公民意识方面也有所提升，能够发挥自己的能量，投身或组织社会的公益活动，比如自发的捐献骨髓，组织开展面向市民的环保宣传活动等等。第四，我想和大家分享我们典型的学生代表。每年我们数以万计的学生从上海开放大学成长起来，其中相当一部分在社会上就卓有成效。杜元军出来上海的时候是在街头卖爆米花的，通过开大的学习成为了机械加工工程师，参与公司多种新产品研发，并且还取得了教师资格证，在择业学校中担任兼职老师，参与编写了技术等级指导教师。朱雪琴从一名普通农民工成长为上海市首位农民工全国人大代表，并且成立了朱雪琴工作室，专门收集并汇总农民工的问题，成为了一名服务大众、服务社会的杰出代表。唐涛，一名小儿麻痹症的患者，放弃了辛苦拼搏获得的全球500强公司的职位，走进开放大学，并且创办了知了工业文化传播中心及实体餐厅和虚拟店铺，他是创业非常成功的一个典型，帮助残疾人就业创业，用自身的能量为社会做贡献。这些就是我们可爱的学生，他们奔跑着、努力着，我们关注着、推动着。学生的成长是我们教学改革最大的动力和目标。第四，向大家报告的是今后我们努力的方向。首先是促进工作场所学习和生活场所学习。现在的工作场所从广义上讲已经扩大，由于移动技术、信息技术的快速发展，其实也包括了家庭，在任何地方都可以进行学习，利用信息技术，所以实现知识学习与实践应用的良好结合，把大学办在社会之中。第二方面，深化梯形人才的培养理念。我们刚才讲到了，梯的树是代表着一个专业技能和专业知识，梯的一横是代表着你的情商和逆境商，是代表着你的沟通能力、合作能力，是代表着你的综合素质。所以在强调对学生专业能力提升同时，要推进对学生情商、逆境商和综合能力的提升，为学生事业成功奠定良好的基础。第三，开展基于大数据技术的学习行为分析研究，推动新兴技术在学习中的应用，促进学习模式的创新。第四，致力于终身学习立交桥的建立，加强非正式的学习、非学历教育及学历教育的学习成果的互认和沟通。以上就是上海开放大学基于学生能力提升方面所做的教学改革，虽然已经初见成效，但未来的任务依旧是任重而道远，改革在前方，我们在路上。谢谢大家。
Thanks, for the president for this award. And I would ask the other presenter, Professor Rotomi Ogidon, to give his talk in the building capacity of staff in research through open and distant education. Professor Rotomi is specialized in the guidance and counselings, and he is a professor in the National University of Nigeria, and now as executive director of the African Council for Distant Education, and he published about 60 papers in the competences and in the guidance and counselings. So, unfortunately, you have only 20 minutes.
Thank you, the chairman. I want to also thank the president of this great university. I know that I've not made any mistake for coming to this university. I've heard and read a lot about this university. I think this university is actually one of the frontline universities in the world. I want to clap for this university. I want to clap for this university. My own university, which is the Open University of National Open University of Nigeria, is a member of the African Council for Distance Education. And I'm a professor in the National Open University of Nigeria, but I am also serving as the executive director of the African Council for Distance Education. And that's why we have this logo, African Council for Distance Education. The title of the presentation, like you have been told, is Building the Capacity of Staff in Research Through Open and Distance Education for the Education We Want in the 21st Century, Challenges, Achievements, and Suggestions for Improvement. We all know that globalization is a common knowledge nowadays, and it can be exemplified by the recent migration of people every day from Africa and Middle East to Europe, America, and Australia. There are also different modes of transportation and communication showing that we are in a globalized world. The interconnectedness of people, however, demands that there should be a collective awareness of the opportunities, threats, and the readiness to develop strategies that will make the world a peaceful and habitable place. Following this, there is therefore need for global collaboration in the field of education, particularly in research, so that problems can collectively be tackled and pushed for intervention for the good of all and sundry. The world is a highly competitive one, and because of this, there is always the need for us to know as researchers what people are doing across the world, so as to be able to share the knowledge in the different areas of ODL, delivery services, and to facilitate improvement in research activities generally. One of other reasons why we need to collaborate, we need to work together, is because of problems, concerns that the whole world is facing nowadays. We have problems in the area of earthquake, different waves of typhoon, global warming, and at the same time, recognize the interconnectedness of academic disciplines that will help to sustain the development of this generation without necessarily compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs, and thereby continuously make the world a better place to live in. The 21st century is very important to us because there are lots of development, there are lots of challenges, but at the same time, there are also lots of hopes, particularly in the area of open and distance education. This afternoon when we went up there, we saw the great work that the Open University of Shanghai is doing in the area of virtual learning. This is great. They have a laboratory where all sorts of studies are carried out. And I'm particularly impressed because of the interdisciplinary nature of the outfit. A situation where psychologists can come in, a situation where ICT experts can come in. We need to collaborate. We need to work together. We need to see the world as a global village. Because if there is a problem in Africa, I do know that those in Europe should get ready. If there is a problem in America, those in Africa should know that the problem in America is also part of their own problem. So there is supposed to be a collective understanding of the concerns in one part of the world to the other. Now, the African Council for Distance Education is a continental organization, and it comprises of the African universities and other higher education institutions in Africa. There are altogether 53 members. Those are the institutions, universities, while we have up to 273 individual academics that are members. The African Council for Distance Education was actually established by the Vice Chancellors in Africa, in South Africa, in the year 2004. And we had the first conference in the year 2005, and then 2008, we had second conference in Nigeria. We also had another conference in Zimbabwe. We had another conference in Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe. The next one is going to be at the Open University of Sudan in the 2017. I've told you that we have 272 members. We have 42 institutional members and 7 associate members. The African Council for Distance Education is an organization that is recognized by the African Union. And it is also the lead institution when it comes to something that happens, that concerns the open and distance learning in Africa. The African Council for Distance Education is into relationship with the Task Force on Teachers Forever. Now, what are the advantages of establishing open and distance learning? Some of the advantages of establishing open and distance learning education are elevation of capacity constraints for economic, human resources, and rural development, education for all, especially to reduce or totally eliminate illiteracy and poverty, capacity building for human resources development, especially in areas of acute deficiencies, lifelong learning and life-wide education to build a learning and knowledge-based society. There are other advantages, like generating spin-off effect on other sectors of development, such as recent development in the telecommunications, information technology, industry, broadcasting, poster and informatics, and the development of many education-related small-scale industries. We need to carry out research, and it has to be globalized in nature because of the educational needs of learners in the 21st century. What are the educational needs? The 21st century learners requires that practitioners should undertake research regularly so as to be able to enhance the acquisition of new skills. In the 21st century, teaching content and instructional materials must reflect changes in the mindset of people, particularly with the perception of change as an inevitable reality for development. In the 21st century, there is supposed to be openness in the method of transmitting knowledge, which requires institutions of learning to come out of the insulator mode of operation, be liberal and open-minded to make the system for teaching and learning functional. I'm happy because open universities generally are supposed to be open in everything. There are other education needs of learners in the 21st century, like to create a mindset that will explore areas which will bring about positive and progressive change in the society. Use of interdisciplinary approach in acquiring knowledge, as opposed to emphasis on the compartmentalization of subjects into arts, science, which for some time has made teaching and learning to be redundant instead of exploring and imbibing the interrelatedness. Like I told you, this afternoon we went up there to the lab and we saw how experts in different areas are concerned. When data are gathered, the psychologist is expected to make use of the data to be able to support the learners. Expert in ICT also has its own role, and so on and so forth. That is the way, that is part of the needs that we expect in the 21st century from the learners. The kind of education we want in the 21st century, it should be the type that integrates technology to be able to ease communication and interaction. Must be resourceful in terms of the daily needs of learners, teachers, and general institutional development. It should possess the components of acceptable quality. It should promote lifelong learning. It should enhance the acquisition of functional skills to secure or create employment in the society. It should explore the knowledge of theories to facilitate practice. It must be all-inclusive so as to be able to address the issues of gender equality with concerns for the migrant population, the displaced people, prison inmates, and women in the PUDA. I don't know whether you are familiar with the issue of a PUDA system. In Nigeria and other West African countries where we have Muslims, there are sections where some women don't go out. It is men who fend for them. How do we just forget about this population of people? No. Open university is supposed to be able to provide support, provide opportunity for these people to be included in the opportunity to be educated. So that even if they don't go out to seek employment, they can still use their knowledge and skill which they have acquired to help their children and help their family. Globalized knowledge where there is constant networking among scholars to ensure that there is quality of delivery that will promote use of valid information and prevent plagiarism, since learners will be aware of what is done in other parts of the world. Now, why do we need capacity? Why do we need to build the capacity of staff in ODL research? Capacity building of staff in ODL research is a major strategy for finding answers to many questions and challenges in distance education, i.e., search for a way of ensuring that higher education is delivered more cost effectively, issue of collaborations and partnership for more efficient delivery, economy of scale with modern and global delivery outlooks, and also to address the issue of effective open and distance learning, including e-learning. We have to remember that open and distance learning is unique. It's not exactly like the conventional system, because the open research in open and distance education do address issues of learner support. We cater for interests of learners that are not within the campus. That is for institutions that operate a complete model of distance education. And similarly, you will discover that in open distance education, use of course materials is emphasized, unlike the conventional system where it has to be face-to-face. So there are peculiarities in the kind of research that are carried out in distance education, unlike what you have in the conventional system. And at the end of the day, by the time research in distance education is carried out, it will enable the ODL practitioners to identify and know the gaps in ODL practices and provide data to fill those gaps which demands for a need to build capacity of academic, professional, and administrative staff in ODL research. What are the strategies? In Africa, so many strategies are being used to build the capacity of staff in ODL research. One of them is collaboration among ODL institutions. That is one institution, an institution in Nigeria, like Open University of Nigeria, cooperates with the Open University of Sudan, cooperate with the Open University of Tanzania to carry out research, and it is reported. In fact, as members of the African Council for Distance Education, institutions that cooperate together to carry out such research, they report it in a meeting, a small conference, quarterly, four times in a year. Another strategy is the training of senior academics from Commonwealth countries and ACDE member institutions in Africa. The distance learning universities in Africa, you see it in that table. There are those that are dedicated to distance education, they are 10. The dual mode, those who use face-to-face are 34. And institutes that do not award certificates, but they are also members of the African Council for Distance Education are 5. The training programs for capacity building, I have partially mentioned that one, during which the academics are brought together, and particularly senior academics, and they are made to cooperate by carrying out research that are able to solve problems in specific areas. That table also shows the capacity building of staff through the attendance of workshop and training in a specific period when academics were engaged in carrying out training to build the capacity of their staff. What are the achievements in building capacity of staff among ACDE member institutions? The achievements are in these areas: create the opportunity for academics to garner knowledge and exposure which have successfully widened the scope of understanding of what ODL research constitutes and how to carry out research activities with focus on ODL peculiarities. Created an awareness of the available human and material resources in academic world. And it has also enabled the members of the African Council for Distance Education to have journals that are ODL based. An example of such journals are the following: the African Council for Distance Education Journal, West African Journal of Open and Flexible Learning, Urea Journal of the Open University of Tanzania, International Open and Distance Learning Journal, 4th ACD Special Edition that is based in Zimbabwe. What are the challenges? These are some of the challenges. Long-term sustainability of building the capacity of staff in ODL research. Need for human, material, and financial resources. Need to continue to improve on the quality of research in ODL. Poor funding of research, again, is common among the higher education institutions in Africa. Suggestions for improvement. These are some of the suggestions. Need for the integration of distance learning mode with conventional, particularly in the area of carrying out research, so as to reduce resistance to ODL innovation and also to overcome the wrong perception that surrounds distance education. International organizations should provide more support in providing capacity building through collaborative efforts, which is exemplified by the Commonwealth of Learning. Similarly, public and private organizations should recognize the need for collaboration in the provision of resources that will sponsor and enhance the development of research that are ODL based. My dear listeners, the global trend for building capacity of staff in ODL research portends that institutions must be ready and able to collaborate by working together and with the industries so as to be able to achieve effective and useful results. Bearing in mind the adage which says, if you want to work fast, work alone. If you want to work far, what do you do? If you want to work far, what will you do? You have to work together. This therefore means that It is in togetherness that we can build the capacity of staff and research through open and distance education to improve the society and thereby make the world a better place to live in. By this, I assure you that ACDE is ready to work with the Shanghai Open University and other institutions across the world in building the capacity of its staff in research through ODL in a globalized world of the 21st century. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Rojami. And I ask the president to give you a certificate for speech. Keynote speaker is David James. He's from the University of UK, and he's graduated from the American universities opening in New York universities for the bachelor and the master, and his PhD from Harvard University. I ask him to give his talk.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Nice to see you, and thank you for inviting me. I'm also here as one of the visiting scholars with the Visiting Scholar Program this time. And so I'd like to say hello to all my visiting scholars that have come this afternoon as well. We're going to spend about 20 minutes or so talking about online distance learning in what I call the post-MOOC world. So, I've got to ask, what does that MOOC stand for? Does anyone know? Can anyone shout out? What does MOOC stand for? Someone must know. Our chair, what does it stand for?
The massive open online course.
Okay, massive, right? Massive. Open. Open. We have open here, okay. Online, all of this technology that we live with in the world every minute of our waking and often sleeping lives, okay? And courses, educating. These massive online open courses, MOOCs, are finding their way all around the world, and they have found their way to Shanghai as well. There are a couple of universities here in Shanghai that have joined a particular organization of MOOCs from the United Kingdom, where I come from Open University in the UK that I'm affiliated with. And we have a corporation affiliated with the university that's called Future Learn. And there are some Chinese universities here in Shanghai that are part of this Future Learn, developing and providing these MOOC courses. So it's not something abstract, it's something that is happening worldwide, including here in Shanghai as well. So where did these MOOCs come from? They're relatively recent. They've really only been born, you could say, in the last 3 or so years. That's not a very long time in terms of their history, their historical development. But so much has happened in those 3 years. So we'll talk a little bit about what has happened in these 3 years, and is there anything we can learn from that in terms of where it's going to continue to go in the future, since it involves so many of our lives. Some of the history comes from the United States. Top universities in the United States, Stanford in California on the West Coast, has two of these organizations that started developing MOOCs, Coursera, and Udacity, and also Harvard, university where I studied, as well as the Massachusetts Institute of Technology down the road from Harvard, came together and formed another organization developing these MOOCs in 2012. And then the Open University in the UK formed FutureLearn shortly thereafter. So these are the, and there are a few others, but these are the major, major players in developing these MOOCs, these massive online open courses. Okay. And they have been sensational, many people would say. They were seen as something that would greatly change, transform higher education. And so we will have a look at what has happened in these three short years and maybe where are we going in this post-MOOC world. A number of academic researchers have been looking at these three short years of MOOCs to try and see what are some things we can learn from them. Marcel Salat says that, reminds us that any educational process has three essential phases to it. We have to have exposure of content. Obviously, we can't learn very much if we don't engage ourselves with the learning, with the material. So we have to first be exposed to the content. That's important. But we also have to learn the content. There has to be learning, what we refer to as pedagogy, right? It's not enough just to become exposed to things. It's not enough to be excited, thrilled by the advances in the technology that are wonderful, but that's not enough. We also have to have learning from it. And the third is we have to find a way that learning has actually happened. We have to verify that the content has been learned by the learners, by us as students. So let's see how MOOCs are doing with those three essential components of an educational process, right? So, they have addressed the first one very well, exposure to content. The MOOCs are available through internet platforms, mobile platforms. So hundreds of thousands, millions of students can potentially access the learning through MOOCs. So exposure, the MOOCs have done an excellent job with that. Very, very good at allowing students to be exposed to learning content. Okay, very good. Because the technology allows us to use broadband, leverage the broadband internet, because that's increasingly available throughout the world in one form or another. So first box is ticked. MOOCs have done a very, very good job with exposure. Let's move to the second one, learning, the pedagogy. What is happening with the pedagogy, with the actual learning of the content, okay? Here we have to look at what educators tell us about learning. Educators and educational psychologists have a lot of research to tell us about what goes on in good pedagogy, okay? And most of the research tells us that in most of the cases, learning is social. Learning is a social process. We know this from babies, from infants. If you take an infant away from the social environment of good parenting, good family structures, we know that there are deficits, declines in their ability to grow emotionally, physically, mentally, and so on. Okay? Humans are the same. We mostly learn in interactions with each other. Most of our learning is embedded in a social context, a social interaction. We can't get away from that as human beings. So how do MOOCs do on that? There can be some problems here, because use of technology to expose students to the learning materials sometimes comes at the expense of the social environment of the learning context. Okay? So this can be very problematic, because you can make the material available, you can make the material interesting, but it doesn't necessarily mean that students are going to learn from it if it doesn't have an enriched social type of context. So what do MOOCs tend to provide? Well, early level, early stage MOOCs have to do with well-known professors, Harvard, Stanford, whatever, delivering lectures, but having them filmed, and instead of 200 people like today listening to that professor in the classroom at Harvard or whatever, all of a sudden now the scale is greatly increased, and maybe 200,000 students can listen to that across the world through internet, okay? But what we find is that it doesn't necessarily give a way for the students to put it in a social interactive process. So MOOCs try to make up for that sometimes by developing forums, right? Online chat rooms where students and people guiding their learning can interact with each other, talk about the material, raise questions, and so forth. Theoretically, this sounds very good. But if you ask a lot of people involved with MOOCs, they will tell you that many of the forums are not used very much. Many students do not necessarily feel the need or understand the need for connecting with them. And the forums really come from a technology that's a generation old. They're clunky. They are not smooth running. And so students will tell you, oh, I'd much rather go, you know, on some social network technology to interact with people rather than classroom forums. So the classroom forums are there to try to fill this gap, but the technology is not necessarily up to speed with what we need to provide a social context for learning. So here in this slide, you see a MOOC learner, and you see the connection is here, and then you see the wires going out into the world, but basically, this learner is very much in isolation. Very much in isolation. And this is a big, big challenge for those of us that believe in education that is enhanced, particularly those of us involved in distance learning, that believe education is enhanced through technology. We know there are limits to this. Let's go back to exposure. As I said, MOOCs have been very good with exposure. And we said the M stands for massive. So there are some courses where 100,000 students all over the world enroll in a course. The average of studies now is that most MOOC online courses enroll about 43,000 students. Still quite large, but it's not terribly massive. We like to think massive is huge, huge, huge. Yes, there are some with 100 or 200,000, but the average is about 42. That means half of them are well below 42,000. Okay. So not quite as massive as we thought they were going to be. That study, by the way, was done by one of our PhD students in educational technology at Open University in the UK. And this just breaks it out a bit more so that you see that most of the MOOCs are over here, under 40,000. So massive depends how you define the word. It's certainly not hundreds of thousands or, you know, a million students taking these MOOCs. It's over the 3 years, it seems to be a smaller number than was first envisioned by them, but still pretty big. Now, let me just tell you in this about exposure, a little bit about FutureLearn, which is the MOOC organization of my university, the Open University in the UK. The Open University has invested a lot of money in their private corporation that develops these MOOCs. Last year, for instance, they invested 10 million pounds, 10 million British pounds were taken from the university budget and put into this corporation, FutureLearn, to develop the MOOCs. A similar amount was done the year before. They believe very much in it, obviously, because the university ran at almost a 17 million pound deficit last year. And with that, still 10 million were invested in the MOOCs. So universities, many universities feel this is the future. This is the way we should be going, okay? It developed its own platform. It runs it, as I said, as a private commercial company. And it's in partnership with 72 other institutions, universities, most in the UK, some around the world. And as I said, two of them are just up and down the road here from Shanghai Open University. Okay, Jiaotong and Fudan are both affiliates, develop and offer MOOC courses through FutureLearn. Okay, and in its second year, FutureLearn has had over 2.5 million people enrolled in its module so far. So, what about the second part? So, we can say yes, exposure has been great through MOOCs to opportunity. Let's look at the second part about what is happening with the learning inside the MOOCs. The word here is maybe questionable. Katie Jordan, one of our PhD students at the OU, has studied this, and her study indicates that of these tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of students that enroll in these MOOC courses, less than 7%, 6.5%, actually complete the course. So many have a great intention when they register and sign up and enroll, but only about 6.5% actually complete the course, okay? And that's relatively recently. She reported that, as I said, in just 2 years ago. Justin Reich at Harvard also did a study on completion rates with MOOCs through their organization, edX, and he found very similar. 6% of students who initially enroll actually end up getting a certificate at the end. So we can say massive, hundreds of thousands start, but a handful end up completing. So this is interesting news, if you look at it that way. Now, some good news is Justin looked at, if you just look at the students who intended to complete and get it, then it goes up to 22%. Some people just take it because out of interest or they have free time or whatever. But those students who want to complete, it does seem completion rates tend to rise to 22%. That's better. But that still means almost 80% aren't getting a completion out of it. I know that's a rough way to measure success and learning, but it's very important. If you think of it, so many signing up, so very, very few actually completing and getting a certificate. And we're not talking long, long courses. Most of these courses run for maybe 6 weeks, 8 weeks, relatively short amount of time and investment, and yet 6% completing. Why do you think there is such high attrition, so much dropout of MOOC courses. A report was released last year at an international conference where they tried to go back and interview with your questionnaires, actually, people who didn't complete MOOCs. They came up with lack of time. A lot of students said, sounded like a great idea at the time, but then once I got into it, my life took over, got in the way, and I just couldn't do it. Lack of learner motivation. This is so important, and already three of the preceding people that have spoke already here before me have talked about the very high importance of student motivation and the support that students need to develop and keep their motivation going. Feeling isolated and lacking interactivity. You probably remember I said that learning is a social activity. If students feel isolated and disconnected, it's not going to happen for them. Insufficient background and skills. Our vice president made an excellent point about that when she was talking about the increase in migrants coming in to the university who may lack basic background and basic skills, not in terms of knowledge. Obviously, so much of life gives people knowledge and understanding, but not in the type of framework that is necessary and useful to put that knowledge to work for future career development. And people finding out, in fact, there are some hidden costs. It sounds, it's free, sign up, it's free. You've heard the old expression, nothing in life is free. And so MOOCs are not necessarily free either. For one thing, many MOOCs charge you money to get that certificate. So if you take the course for free, but if you want the certificate at the end, you have to pay to get that certificate. So that's one example of a hidden cost. But there's other hidden costs. I have to take time away from my personal life, my family life, my work life, etc., to go into an online course like this. So that's a hidden cost many students don't know. Apologies for how small the slide is to read. Other researchers have tried to put the reasons why people don't succeed in online distance learning in a more systematic way. And there are three headings on the top here of reasons why these researchers feel that students do not succeed in online distance education. The first is called situational factors. Your situation, what is going on in your life? So, employment pressure. We already know that the majority of our students are in employment, but they're in the early, early days and years of employment. And so it takes even more energy out of them. Financial pressures, family commitments. You saw, for example, on the small video of the SOU, trying to make learning family learning. Because otherwise, if you are at odds with your family over your learning, your education is going to lose. Your family is going to win. So you have to find a way to put them together. The context of the study, as we said, feeling isolated, and health reasons of students. Disabled students, for example, are greatly drawn into online distance learning, but they need tremendous amounts of support and assistance in order to succeed with it. So these are situational. There are dispositional factors. Disposition means inside the person. Something to do, for example, with our own personality, maybe, who we are as a person. So our motivation, goal setting, also, our vice president pointed out, many of our students don't have clear goals in life or careers yet, okay? Self-confidence, I'm giving your whole speech again. She talked about self-confidence in terms of many of our students are lacking in self-confidence. That's another reason why. And therefore, they're not satisfied, and their learning styles don't match up with what we give them. Many students have complaints of what we are trying to do in online learning, say, it doesn't meet my particular need of my learning style. And then there are institutions, okay? Our institutions get in the way as well. There are a lot of reasons. Our course designs, how we respond, and how we support them, okay? So I think your slides will tell you other things about the OU, and our attrition rates are no better than the reports we said. They're no better than that. And a lot of people have also said that these MOOCs may be very good for specific things like designing certificates for companies that have specific needs, because you can charge them for that, but you are taking, as we saw with the OU, taking money out of what you would do with your own students and putting them into professional development support. So, there are dilemmas. How are we going to deal with these pressures? How are we going to deal with student motivation and self-confidence and learning styles? Someone once said that predictions are hard, especially about the future. And I think that is particularly true here. We only have 3 years, so where is the future going? Very hard to predict. And I will end with this point. Scale, we talked about scale. Scale means, you know, like we were saying, 1 to 200,000 students, you only need one professor reach 200,000 students versus 1 in 20. But scale can be many things in English. This scale, this fish has a scale. And another Chinese animal has a scale, not a real animal, mythical animal. What one is that?
Dragon.
The dragon, okay, the dragon. So, old Chinese proverb about the man who just wished his whole life waiting to meet the dragon, building up this idea of the dragon, and so excited to see a dragon, and one day the dragon finally shows up at his house. The man doesn't know what to do with it at that point. So I would say it could be that the dragon's name was MOOC. Thank you.
Thank you very much. David, thank you for this open online courses and MOOCs, which is maybe the learning of the future. And I asked the Professor Wang Liu, Deputy Party Secretary of Shanghai, to present the service. He will talk about the scalable support activities for open online education. And he's from Netherlands University, working mainly in technology enhancement learning. And he's a specialist in this, and he wrote many publications.
Okay, thank you, dear Chairman, dear President, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very honored to be allowed to present here, so for me it's a big honor. I'm Peter von Rosmalen. In my daily work, I'm both a lecturer in instructional design And in addition, I do research and technology enhanced learning. So I make a very nice combination of trying to integrate instructional knowledge and technological knowledge. To give you a little bit of a brief introduction of my institute, because I'm from a very small country, I'll start first with that before going to the main part of the presentation. I'm from the Open University of the Netherlands, from many of you better known as Holland, and we are a university with 7 bachelor and 9 master programs in many faculties, humanities and law, management, science, technology, psychology and educational science. Myself, I'm located in educational science, and our number of students might seem very small, but we are from a small language area. We have 17,000 yearly enrollments. All our students are working students, they're part-time, and they are in the age range of 20 to 80 years old. Some people like to study even when they're old. On average, I would say our students are between 30 and 45 years old. The Welty Institute, where I'm officially working, is part of the Psychology and Educational Science departments, and it offers a Master of Educational Science and a research program devoted completely to learning and teaching in technology-enhanced learning environments. So we both cover the cognitive aspects, technology aspects, and also concentrate on how to teach teachers to go on with this usage of technology in their learning and teaching. Our institute has 55 staff members permanent, and we also supervise 20 internal PhD students and around 80 external, which work in other organizations for learning or in companies. This is about my organization. I'll now give you a little bit of a background on scalable support, what I'm thinking about scalable support. It goes in detail where David stopped in his previous talk. When I talk about scalable support, immediately the following picture comes to the mind. It's about the iron triangle between scale, quality, and cost. I call it iron because if you change one of the sides, it always affects the other side. If you get more students, either you increase the cost, because if you keep it the same, you will influence badly the quality. The iron triangle is very well known from the health sector. With increased quality of medical treatments, people getting older, but people also are better aware of what they want from the doctor. So that really challenges governments to keep costs and control quality at the same time. The same applies for any kind of situation where you have people and services. So the same applies also in our domain of education. I'll show you some examples. If you look to the left, you see also again the triangle. Take it and go to the daily classroom. If you have the discussion of instead of 20, you go to 40 students in a classroom, you immediately will change the quality. Or take another challenge in education. We say we want better learning materials or better qualified teachers. Again, the cost will increase. Now look at the right side. These are some figures from UNESCO and the Council of Distance Education. About 15 years ago, we had around 100 million, let's say, students in tertiary and higher education. The predictions for the year 2030, so that's 15 years ahead, we are over 400 million. So we really have to challenge to meet a very big challenge. And if you look at what we at the moment believe are indicators to accreditate education, so quality indicators, then we talk about teacher quality, student-staff ratio, so we think there is a maximum or beneficial maximum, and we talk about contact hours, no matter whether it's virtual or physical. So these are the indicators, so that gives also a little bit of a feeling that also in education, the triangle is really made of iron and not easy to work with. Obviously, some of you probably will already be thinking, but we are from distance teaching, and we already had it as one hour of our main focuses when starting founding missions of many open universities. It was delivery at scale. Nevertheless, even the Council of Distance Education acknowledged in a report of this year that with the increased demand for rapid responses to inquiries, increased personalization, driven by expectations set by maybe not perfect, but available online services in the commercial sector, we challenge the economies of scales achieved and take into account also the huge increase of students expected. Also our sector of open and distance education is really seriously challenged. And then from my perspective, another study of 2015, which showed the amazing result that if you look at ICT use in classroom, that the interesting result is if there is little use in the classroom of ICT and a lot, in both cases, the students do worse than when there is average use of ICT in the classroom. So you see there is definitely a pedagogical challenge to make beneficial ICT use in the classroom. So in this set of constraints, I try to do my job and try to contribute something. Let's move on to which very closely related to the previous speakers. When you look at open online education, you can look top down from the organization and try to manage, educate your teachers, give fundings, etc. to do the job. But there is also another perspective. That's the learner. What do we know about our learner? What do we know actually about their motivations? What do we know about their skills to study independently at home? So far, if you look at many studies, there are many that acknowledge that motivations of our students are not really deeply understood. Neither we are sure whether students at home are really capable to self-regulate their learning. So in starting this year, we got funded from the Dutch government to do a large study to look at these various aspects. So top down, how do organizations support open online learning, but also bottom up, what do our learners are capable of? What do they want? Can they do the job themselves? And at the middle level, where my interest lies, how can we make scalable support solutions and how can we make educational designs? So summarizing, that was also the challenge for my visit here, for my scholarship visit for these 2 weeks. How can tutoring and student support in open online education be implemented for a really very large number of students, which is very important in our environment, varying backgrounds, while still controlling and maintaining cost and qualities. So the challenge is to look at best practices, possibilities, but also to recognize problems and needs and to learn from each other. How Shanghai Open University looks at these things and how we, in our small environment in the Netherlands, look at similar problems. I now go give you some thoughts about support, intro, how we look at the scalable support, and examples. See me as a gardener who, like in Chinese garden, looks around for nice flowers and beautiful stones, and hope to show you some examples you like and that you can learn from. In no way I pretend to be exhaustive, because as any gardener knows, no garden is ever complete. It will always grow, and new things will happen. David talked about the MOOCs, you see there is the real focus is mainly on the content. So you at the bottom, in the bottom left corner, you see content. But where learning is about, there is a teacher, there is content, there is a student. So there are actually three actors. And a lot of times when in open online education, we only think about one actor and one we don't see. So we see the content as a teacher designer, the student is hidden, and the teacher, when his job is done, is away on holiday or whatever. However, there is more. I mean, if you look at the statement to the right from Anderson from 2002, you see if we want really deep and meaningful learning, it can be offered, but it's about interaction and engagements. So we should at least support one of the three, or maybe even more, so student-teacher interaction, or student-student interaction, or student content interaction. And one of these at least should be at a very high level to achieve what we want if we offer open online education and likely also in traditional classroom education. So the challenge, our challenge, my challenge, is can we open the iron triangle? So can we develop tools and methods, because that's the advantage of offering things open and online. Technology doesn't get tired, so if we can develop technology which we can support these type of interactions, we do it one time for many people, for many type of situations. I'll lead you now through a number of examples. Let's first look to the student and student interactions. In the top, you see a very old saying of Confucius. I actually borrowed it from the East China Normal University. It was at their website. If three of us are walking together, at least one of the other two is good enough to be my teacher. Interestingly enough, we all acknowledge this, but if you look in an open online environment, we don't see any evidence. While this saying is many centuries old, so you would think we have thought about it and we should do something about it. I give you three examples. First look at the drawing at the bottom, then I talk about it. The situation we're in now is a teacher with many students. I was only drawing six because 2 million don't fit on one page. And to the left you see a completely new situation. The teacher is disappeared, it's actually in the background, and you see students. Like Confucius is saying, working together, relying on each other, trusting on each other capabilities. I give you three examples, and there are many, many more, how this was implemented. The first one is my original PhD work. It's about question answering. Everyone knows that in the educational process, phrasing a question is already a moment of articulation. What do I know or what I don't know? So this is a very important didactical element in learning. Answering equally well. If another student is able to give you an answer, this is a very important process of engagement in the learning model. What we did, we said, forums don't work. If I pose a question to 1 million people, there are 1 million people who are not involved with me. What we do is we go for knowledge dating, so make it popular. We go to automated peer selection. We supply tools and methods to support the selection and to support the people involved. And we have a very strict, to make things clear, collaboration script. In practice, it meant with language technologies, we analyze the question, we look where it belongs in the course, and we look at students who are at the same stage of study, and we assume, obviously, they're knowledgeable. And in the studies, it appeared they were knowledgeable, and because they were personally asked, they were also involved and engaged. And as a net side effect, it also meant that in an anonymous world, there was some community building. So from knowledge dating to maybe even another kind of dating, but obviously not intended. Another thing is, if you look at student capabilities, a lot of online learning environments lack regular, say, assessment. It's, most of the times it's fairly primitive. We offer quizzes, but in natural life, if you ask an engineer, even an engineer, given from available results, spend 20 to 40 percent of its time in writing reports. So even an engineer, and I don't know any engineer, maybe you know, who's filling in quizzes. So let's go to the natural behavior of students. But obviously, giving feedback to open assignments is a very laborsome job. But why not use students? They get also a better understanding of the troubles other students have. And if you create a system which takes into account balances, so that you take care that you don't have probably a student who doesn't know and give you feedback, but if you take care and calculate it in an algorithmic way, you can make very nice, say, peer assessment systems which take into account many variables, and students are quite happy with that. Another thing, what likely doesn't happen very much in online learning either, is collaborative learning. One of the first reasons is that it's very difficult to create teams which in a good way can work together. Again, you can automate this, you can look at the profiles of students, their capabilities, their personalities, and one of my PhD students made a small program who, based on personality characteristics and knowledge characteristics and interest, created the so-called ideal team. And all of these, they share an automated peer selection, tools and methods to support it, and a very strict collaboration script. So nothing alien here, it's with today's technology. Let's move to a slightly more detailed and even more simple example. Every one of us knows that games receive much attention in education, but games tend to be very complex. But if you look at children in the street, they play very simple games. So the principles of games are actually very simple and can apply also to higher education. And my point of view is that simple game designs can be really useful. And a couple of years ago, we created a game which was called Argument, and the name tells itself. What's more important in academic life or in higher education or for anyone is to be able to argument on something. So what we did? We created an environment in which there were automatically created small teams to discuss a given position. And each team was simply asked to defend their opinion with arguments, counter-arguments. They were even stimulated to use external references because we were working in an academic environment, so putting a literature ref to it was a real positive affordance. And to make it a game-like world, teams were scoring each other, so for best scores. Okay, so the principle was simple, a team pro and a team against. And the funny thing was that some people were even angry because they don't want to be against, I'm pro. But afterwards, obviously, they were very happy, they learned. And this thing was a very simple game round, short essay, five arguments, counter arguments, a closing pitch, almost normal life. Some other examples, which many of you could easily use. To the left, if you're working in the cultural domain, a game which people which are interested in culture and learned a lot, guide them around the town, and they have to assess buildings on various characteristics. So they get direct feedback on their knowledge. To the right, with the famous learner analytics, not just for the teacher, but also give feedback on your performance as a student. And to the bottom, if you have open text assignments, this very simple tool creates the main keywords and compare this with a model assignment. So you can yourself see how far you're on the right road in your assignment. Do you encapsulate the main keywords? Which one are you missing? On which one do you add? So you yourself can create a judgment. And then for a closing, a very complex one, because we obviously also try, we were in the learning in the lab this morning, and there were much uses about. Okay, people want to see more than another time. Apologize.
Thank you very much. And I ask Koshimi to present the certificate.
Thank you.